All right, why don't we get started? I would like to thank everybody for coming out today, which is going to be the last event of the semester for the Center for Ethics and Public Policy. That being said, there is another event, not by the center, but by the department in which we are housed, the Department of Philosophy, and that event will be occurring tomorrow, and it'll be by our own Professor David Gore, and the topic will be the rhetoric of historical recurrence in political regimes, and the room in which it'll occur is 425 A.B. Anderson at 5 o'clock. I definitely encourage you to come. Professor Gore is a very interesting speaker. I also want to take the time to thank our assistant, Yasmina. Yasmina has been incredibly helpful, and a lot of the events that we've been able to conduct this semester, the reason they've gone off as well as they have is due in large part to Yasmina, so I'm very, very grateful for her assistance. I'm happy she can continue. I'd also like to thank Liz for coming up for this. Of course, just so you know, I don't know if I told you this, you're not getting paid. But Liz is the executive director for the Minnesota Coalition for the Homeless. She has been working in various capacities with the Minnesota Coalition for the Homeless since 2001. She was also a Eveleth City Councilor. I think it was from 2007 to 2010. And she's also the 2011 recipient of the Simpson Housing Services Champion Award for her advocacy work. And also, quite importantly, she is a former alum. She actually received her master's here in advocacy and political leadership and from UMD. So without further ado, please let's give a warm welcome to Liz.
Thanks so much. It's great to be here. Before we get started, I want to take just a little quiz temperature in the room, since this is on campus and campuses love quizzes. On a scale of 1 to 10, this is going to be a quiz on just your knowledge and experience with homelessness. So on a scale of 1 to 10, 9s and 10s are people who are maybe homeless themselves, or family members are homeless, or you work in a homeless program, or you're pretty familiar with homelessness. You're kind of on the scale of 9 and 10. 1 and 2 is, you know, you maybe seen it once somewhere on a highway exit or something, but, you know, or read about it in the newspaper, but pretty unfamiliar. How many of you would say, just by show of hands, closer to 7, 8, 9, 10, pretty familiar with homelessness? Okay. How many of you would say you're closer to 1, 2s, and 3s? Okay, that's great. Great to be here then. This is about policy as well, and a lot of our work is about shaping public policy. So, and my work especially is focused at the state legislature, but we'll talk local government as well. So another quiz, this one on just your knowledge and experience with the state legislature. So 9 and 10, if you're pretty familiar, maybe you've run for office or you've worked as a page at the legislature, you know, somewhere down that way, if you've been down to Days on the Hill. 1 and 2, if you like vaguely remember ninth grade civics, or you know there was an election, you know, recently for governor or something. So how many of you closer to 8, 9, 10, pretty familiar? How many of you closer to 1 and 2? How many of you consider yourself kind of in the middle? Excellent. So I work for the Minnesota Coalition for the Homeless. We're a coalition of 150 service providers all across the state. And really, that's where our power comes from. I'm just kind of a connector of folks who do the real work and try to shepherd our work together. And so I'm happy to be joined here by Deb Holman, who will come up and just come hang out with me here. So first, just a little bit about MCH, and then Deb will introduce herself a little bit. We'll do a little just background overview on homelessness, then we'll do a little bit about what we can do about homelessness through public policy, and then we'll talk specifically about what each of you can do if you're moved to do something to pitch in. So first, as I said, the Coalition for the Homeless, coalition of 150 service providers across the state. We got started in 1984. I don't know if you're familiar with the parable of the babies in the river, but the idea is in this mythical village far, far away, someone noticed a baby in the river one day, and so they jumped in and pulled it out. And the next day there were two babies, and then four babies, and eight babies, more and more babies in this village in the river every day. And so pretty soon people started gathering down at the riverbanks early in the morning because they could anticipate these babies were going to come. And then pretty soon they built up watchtowers and emergency response systems. And someone said, well, what if we go upstream to find out where these babies are coming from? And people are like, oh, we can't spare a single person to go upstream. We have to, you know, it's real busy work right here pulling babies out of the river. So in 1984, homelessness was just starting to increase in a big way in Minnesota, all across the state. And service providers started saying, like churches opened up basements and said, we'll take the single adults, you take the youth, you take the families. And then what if we send someone upstream to find out what public policies are causing this increase in homelessness? And so they pooled their resources, formed a coalition, and since then, we've been trying to pay attention to what's going on at the state capitol and advocating for policy. So we'll talk much more about what those policies are. But before we start talking about just homelessness overall, Deb's going to say just a little bit about what she does here in town.
Okay, hi. I got to say I'm surprised there's so many of you that aren't familiar with homelessness, so I'm glad that we're here. Maybe we can teach you a little bit about what's going on in Duluth and the state as well. But I'm Deb Holman. I work at the CHUM. You guys, does anybody know what the CHUM is? Okay. It's our homeless shelter in town, but it has a lot of different, there's a lot of different umbrellas under the roof of CHUM, and we can talk about that maybe later. I actually do the street outreach, so I'm mostly working with the outside population, and I've been doing that for a number of years. I spent a few years on the board of the Minnesota Coalition for the Homeless. I was just telling Liz I'm not really board material. So spent some time doing outreach in the city, so it's kind of my passion, and that's what I'm doing here in Duluth. So
we wanted to start with just kind of an overview of what homelessness looks like. And so statewide, we estimate there's about 14,000 Minnesotans who are homeless every single night. 14,000. For some of you who aren't numbers people or can't imagine 14,000, I encourage you to just remember Minnesota is the land of 10,000 lakes. We have more than 10,000 people homeless every single night, and they're either homeless or being housed in temporary like emergency shelters or temporary homeless programs. So a huge, huge number. About half of them are children and youth, and so I think a lot of times when people think of homelessness, they think of a single adult, often chronic alcoholic, someone with serious and persistent mental illness. So let's do just shout outs about why it is that in Minnesota we don't see homeless children and youth if they make up half of the homeless population. Thoughts on why we might not see them? Is that a hand? No? Or how about a challenge to that? Do you feel like you do see that, and that's something you all were pretty familiar with? All right, let's talk about why these youth and children are homeless, and maybe this will give you some clues, and then we'll come back to taking answers. So the single biggest reason families are homeless are because they're fleeing domestic violence, and youth are homeless, so we call them children if they're with an adult in their life, and youth, no matter what age they are, anywhere from like 10 to 21, if they're not with an adult in their life. And so youth are oftentimes homeless because they came out as gay or lesbian, were kind of evicted from their family homes, especially we see that in rural areas. They're also homeless because they're leaving the foster care system and don't have a transition, someplace to go. Homeless because of just deep, deep poverty, and so, sometimes they just have to leave and try to make it so the younger mouths can be fed. So let's come back to the question about why we might not see these children and youth who are homeless. The way we sometimes see, and we'll talk a lot more about how we don't see the adults very often either, but thoughts on why we don't see them. Yeah?
Are they in like shelters and homes and things?
That's a good point. A lot of them are. When we survey homeless youth and we find out about 90% of them are going to school during the day, and we ask like, why are you going? I mean, like, we love that you're going to school, but tell us more about this, because your life has been just one crisis, chaos, you know, after another. And so some of the homeless youth tell us, well, school is a warm place to be during the day. Others tell us it's where there's a caring adult. You know, I have a teacher who really, you know, takes care, you know, checks in, treats me like a human being. Others say I'm just so driven to make sure that I do better than my parents have been able to do for me. So a lot of times they're in school. I think other folks, like especially for young children, if they're with a parent, the parent doesn't want to lose the children for neglect, and so they'll hide. If they're fleeing domestic violence, it's sometimes very unsafe for them to be found, and so they'll hide. This number doesn't include most of the doubled up. So a lot of folks are doubled up, but they're not included in this count of 14,000. And so they are people who are moving about, but not being seen, partly for safety reasons, but all kinds of other reasons. Do you want to talk a little bit about the homeless adults? And
yeah, I think here in Duluth, I just want to add one comment to the children thing too. I think that one of the reasons maybe you guys don't see them is because, you know, you come from a system of poverty. Maybe some folks in the room do, but you know, they're maybe not in your neighborhood. So, you know, before I started doing this work, I grew up in Cloquet. I knew nothing about homelessness until I moved to Minneapolis, and then I took an interest in it. But, you know, if you're not paying attention, if it's not something that's in your neighborhood, you know, you probably don't know about it. So that might be one reason why you're not seeing it. I do know that in working with homeless adults, we've had people camping out up in the woods here around UMD. Lots of times homeless folks will, you know, hang out in the college libraries, the library, just for like a warm place to stay. So I did give the assistant, we have an outreach hotline now that, you know, maybe we can spread the number around to the whole class too before we leave today, because, you know, we need help. Duluth is 26 miles long. There's people living outside in vehicles, in campers, in tents, you know, in skyways, all over the place. And they're kids, they're families, they're kids, they have pets, and they're single adults. So I don't have a good handle on who's outside right now. I know every year we do a homeless count. We do it in January, which is, you know, a lot of people are doubled up on a 30 below night in January. But I think last year in Duluth, our single adult count was around 130. I'm not remembering the exact number. So on a 20 below, 30 below, 40 below night, there was 130 people sleeping outside in Duluth. I think we're doing a little better. I don't have my coworker here too, Susan from Chum. So if you can think of anything to throw in, Susan, raise your hand. Yeah. So she's great. She's our Social Security advocate and talks to everybody that comes through the Chum.
How does someone stay alive when they're outside and it's 20 below?
You know, I ask myself that question a lot. You know, think of how you are just maybe warming up your car, how cold that is. These guys are resilient. Last year we saw a lot of frostbite, so, you know, we're starting to reach out in different areas. You know, if you think about when we're not meeting homeless folks, you know, they're using the emergency rooms, they're using our detox centers. So part of it is building relationships in the community. So people like you folks that are maybe unaware of homelessness, you know, can learn something so you can help us help these guys that are living outside. So last year, because of the outreach hotline and the community tips, we reached a lot of people that otherwise would have had no support or help. You know, when people are living in cars and living in tents, you know, they don't have money for gas to keep their cars running. You know, the money only lasts so long. So the community has really stepped up and, you know, tried to help us with this. So, you know, I'm sure, maybe, have you ever seen somebody flying a sign up at Walmart or up by Shopko? Or have you ever seen someone flying a sign? How many have? So that would be maybe kind of the thing we'd want to tip on, because if you call the outreach line then and say, hey, there's somebody flying a sign up here by Target, you know, we would come and try to meet that person. We may know them, we may not. So the most important thing about outreach for me with single adults is that first connection. If we never meet them, we don't know they're there. And people can hide really well, you know. I think, I think at the Chum shelter, we have, I don't know, what would you say, 5 to 8 people, Susan, that, I mean, they're so mentally ill that they've made Chum their home. They're off of medications, our systems fail them. That's where some of the stuff the coalition does at the legislative level, and Chum does it too at the legislative level. Advocate for some policy change to, make some changes so people can get mental health treatment, they can get access to maybe chemical dependency treatment or addiction treatment a little quicker than, what we're getting now. Because, sometimes I could say Chum is kind of the mini Miller Dwan with no services a lot of times. We're seeing a lot more homeless families, and in my opinion, we're seeing a lot more elderly people becoming homeless. It's like your grandpas, your grandmas, your grandpas, they're ending up at, they don't have a support system, they're ending up at homeless on the streets or in shelters. So
I think a couple of stereotypes just be aware of and to understand, and we can discuss this much more later, but one is people tell me like the homeless want to be homeless or something, like there's the homeless. And I want you to think about homelessness not as the homeless, but it's like an ever-changing. It's true that we have some folks who are homeless for a long, long time, and we're really trying to prioritize getting them stably housed, and folks are doing a great job of that in Duluth and across the state by getting them a place to live and getting them services to keep them stable. But in general, people who are experiencing homelessness are, it's just very temporary, 6 months or something, and they're people who are living in deep poverty. But so when we talk about the homeless, they're different people all the time. And, it's kind of like if you imagine like a moving, if we were playing musical chairs and we're all moving about, and then we take a snapshot, and at one time those are, but, people will get housed and other people will become homeless. And so trying to create a system where when people run into a crisis, they're not becoming homeless. So that's closing the door to homelessness. And then we're trying to get people housed who are homeless. Another kind of stereotype we often hear from people who've never really known a homeless person is that, you probably hear this sometimes, people tell me like they should get a job. Just get a job, I work hard, get a job. So I want you to know that before the recession, which is the last year we have real good numbers, and then we have some recession numbers, but lots of people were having a hard time working then. 41% of homeless adults were working, and they just weren't making enough to make ends meet. And then of the ones who weren't working, many of them have lots of health challenges and other things they're struggling with, but will be working again, and were working previously, but on the night of that study, they maybe weren't. And then some have just like a lot of disabilities and may never be able to hold down a job and need more care. We start, anything to add to that, or challenge? Okay, so we start by saying the Coalition for the Homeless started in 1984 because homelessness was just kind of starting to happen in the state. And so, I mean, we'd had some, but not the large scale homelessness where it's hundreds and thousands of homeless people every night. And so we believe at my shop that it was public policy that made that happen, and it will be public policy that stops it from happening. And so the public policies of the early 1980s were primarily the Reagan administration did 3 things at the federal level that affected homelessness across the entire country. And so one thing he did was this country used to give tax incentives to developers who would build affordable housing, housing that was affordable for people to live in. You might not be able to make a big profit on that as a developer, but we recognized that was a public good, and we said, let's give tax incentives to developers to build that kind of housing so that we could have more of it. And so we cut those tax incentives in the early 80s. We have 2 kinds of federal housing programs. One is Section 8, or rental assistance, where you take a voucher from the federal government, if you qualify, and you can take it to a private landlord. And this voucher says the federal government will pay, you pay 30% of your income in rent, and the federal government will pay the rest. And so as your income increases, the federal government's responsibility comes down. And so those vouchers, President Reagan cut quite dramatically. And so people had less access to those to go take to the private market at the same time that we were developing less private market housing. And then the third thing President Reagan did was another housing option is housing that is owned by the federal government, public housing. And so there had been some large public housing complexes that were run down and had lots of crime and were getting a bad rap. Lots of really good public housing all across the state and the country as well, but President Reagan decided we will stop investing in building that public housing at the rate we had been previously. And so all three of those kind of impacts on the housing market happened at the same time and very quickly. Over the next couple of years, we've seen this increase in homelessness. And since then, the feds haven't fixed that. It continues to be real hard for developers to develop affordable housing, for people the Section 8 waiting list to get those vouchers that you can take to a private landlord. In some communities across Minnesota, that waiting list is open for just like 20 minutes every 3 years or something. Like the need is so great. And then with public housing, we just haven't kept up as much as we need, even maintaining the units we have, let alone building new ones. So in Minnesota, we try to beef that up with trying to add some state dollars to at least maintain the federal units we have. Questions or discussion about that before we move on? Yeah.
Yeah, so we've received $162 million from the legislation. And what are we going to see to do with Middleton and Arrowhead and the development on 2100? And the rental prices, even at Middleton School District, are going to be, they're going to receive $5.3 million from the government. Sherman Associates is going to put $800,000 into the development. And they're still going to have to require subsidies from the government to pay these rents, which are going to be at the lowest $300, and half of them are still going to be market rate. So they're still looking to make money, and this is a 0% interest loan over 30 years. And so the amount we're receiving from the government, they're still, the companies are still looking, the developers are still looking to make money, and we have, what, 25% of Duluth makes less than $25,000 a year?
So are you saying the developers are getting rich off of the government money we're putting into it?
I think we need to maybe look into it a little bit further. There's even like 85% of the entire money that we develop this school, or the development on 2100 is even going, they're going to be even looking at more luxury apartments, and there's going to be over 100 of those. That's going to be a $36 million project.
Yeah.
So we're not really directly like needing more chum centers.
That's a great great pivot. I think we'll come back to this, but it's a great pivot to, I wanted to talk about how we make public policy, and we being, you know, the collective we in this kind of system. And so I want to come back to that as part of this discussion. So remind me if we get way off track. But so with the art of public policy making, I sometimes talk about it like this. If you imagine all of us are in a really warm place, Death Valley or someplace, much warmer than here, and we're on like this huge bus that all of us fit on, and we were going to go down to enjoy some sunshine, and the bus broke down, and we all thought people would know where to find us, but we find our phones stop working, and we're stranded out in this desert. We've eaten all the snacks we have and drank all the water, and we're 3 days into this being stranded, and nobody seems to be coming to find us, and there's no road. I mean, like, the road going forward and back, there's just no help anywhere. And we're starting to be really sick, and, you know, running into dehydration and, you know, other challenges. So you with me? I know this Minnesota in winter, it might be hard to imagine, but we're stranded out there in the super heat, and we're starting to really worry about if we're going to make it or not. And then someone finds my water bottle, this water bottle with this much water in it, and they say, "Oh my goodness, this, you know, like, we're all parched." And so the art of public policy making is to figure out how to divide up this water in a way that can work for us somehow. So what if there's no right or wrong answer? So what if we just call it out? If you found this water, someone came to you and said, "Hey, I found this water." What do you think would be something we could do with it? Like, how would we divvy it up? Any answer? It doesn't
divide equally between people that are there.
Yep. So all of us get like a fourth a teaspoon or something. Yep. Yep. Like wet our finger and yeah.
Give it to one person. Have them go.
Yep. Take the bottle with it. Keep them alive. Go for help. Good answer. Other. Yeah.
So you're trying to relate this to that we have a scarcity-based housing market. There's not enough to go around. Like what? Is that what you're kind of relating to?
Well, we're coming back to that. For right now, we're just still in how do we divide the water.
Okay. I don't have an answer for that.
Huh? No answer?
No.
Yeah?
Because the people that need it the most, the ones that are really looking like they are in dire need.
Yep. And who decides who's looking like they're in most dire need?
I don't know. I'd say the ones that are suffering the most from dehydration, physical.
Yeah. Yeah, and sometimes when I ask this question, people say, like, give it to the, I mean, all of these answers are like yours, divide it four ways and send four people off for help and find the four strongest, to, you know, who are most likely. Or some people say, give it to the pregnant women, you know, or some people say, give it to the person who found it and their three best friends, like finders keepers, you know, like, I mean, there's like any number of things, you know, give it to the blue-eyed people, give it to the brown-eyed people, give it to the people over 60, or give it to the people under 12, or, you know, there's any number of ways we can divide it up. But I think the way our system of government works at the city, at the county, at the state, at the federal government is, this is what they're deciding all the time, is we have a pot of money, and what should we do with it? And it's true, to your point, we could make it bigger, right? Like, we could dig a well and get more water, but still, a group of people are making these decisions. And very often, the people making the decisions about housing and homelessness are not people who have ever been ever been homeless or have ever really even known a homeless person. And so the decisions they're making about whether we should be housing people or not are affected a little bit by what they, you know, by their experience. That makes sense? So in a very similar analogy, I want to show you for the state of Minnesota, this represents beans for like accountants who count beans here in the business center, I guess. This is about $400 million of beans. And this is what we give in tax breaks in Minnesota state policy. We give it in tax breaks for people because they own a home. So this is the mortgage interest deduction. You deduct it on your federal taxes, but it also carries through to your state taxes. So as a state, we've decided that this is real important. And it doesn't matter whether your home is, or whether your personal income is $30,000 or $600 million. It doesn't matter. In fact, you get more beans the larger your debt is on your house. And so it's really incentivizing people to take out huge mortgages. So the idea of it at the time at first passed was that we were going to incentivize home ownership. But this is where that pie is growing. And just for comparison, I want to show you this. This is what we spend in the state of Minnesota for all the housing and homeless programs combined for homeless folks and low income compared to this. And so our state legislature, when they look at where to put the beans, they're like, give it to, you know, give it to. And so, and there's all kinds of decisions depending on who's doing this. I'm not at all advocating that we take all these beans away. Some of it might have real good public policy purposes. But I just think that maybe there's room to have a conversation about, like, what if your second home or what if your third home didn't mean you got to keep, you know, you get more beans because of that? Like, is that a way to find a few more beans for this jar? Make sense? So I want to do another similar, just one other state policy thing that's similar, but I don't have beans for. When we pass tax breaks in state policy, they stay a tax break until someone comes and changes it. Whereas when we do appropriations, when we spend money, It only lasts for 2 years, and then the legislature has to decide we're going to do that, spend that money again, and they have to reconsider that every 2 years. So sometimes businesses or a group of people will come and advocate for a tax break. That might make a lot of sense at the time. So there was a winter, I don't remember if it was the 80s or 90s. I know it wasn't 92 or 93 when we had the big Halloween snowstorm. But there was a winter when we didn't have a lot of snow up here. And the folks at the ski hills, Giants Ridge and Lutzen, and these folks went to the Capitol and said, please give us a tax break on snowmaking equipment. You know, like, we're going to have fewer people coming to ski at our ski hills because there's less snow. It's a big part of our economy up here. And, you know, so give us a tax break on snowmaking equipment. Which probably was a real smart public policy thing, you know, or you could argue it was a smart public policy thing to do at the time. But once you pass that, it stays in law forever until someone comes and changes it. And so this year and last year and all the years we've had record snowfalls, we've continued to give $400,000 a year to snowmaking equipment and grooming equipment more than we put into homeless shelters in the state. And so anyway, I just think there's ethical, you know, or there's considerations in, like, how do we decide, And so this question about how do we decide what kind of housing we should invest in is very, very similar to me, I think, because the people who want nice houses and want to build nice houses, they're very happy to go and advocate for that point of view. Whereas the people who just need anything at all, you know, a cot on the floor or, you know, affordable housing, they've got a lot of other stuff going on. And so the legislature sometimes is skewed towards incentivizing the people who already have a lot. Does that make sense? And so our job, part of what we're going to talk about, is how we can skew it the other way. Like, it's like some of those policies make a lot of sense, and we need to have them. But there's opportunities, I think, to also advocate. And there's good reason, actually, to advocate, not just because we care in our hearts about our fellow neighbors, but we know, too, that it saves our state money. It saves taxpayer money when we stably house someone. So for every person, every homeless person we house, for every dollar we invest in housing them, it saves $1.44 in other state investments. So you invest a dollar, it saves the state $1.44. Make sense? So the reason it saves money is partly because we're not paying for emergency room visits and detox visits and police calls to tend to people in crisis situations on the street. That's part of it. Not all homeless people are using all of those services. And so it also helps the state. The state collects most of its money through income taxes, and so as people get stably housed, their incomes go up and they're paying more, and so that's the other way it balances out. But for every dollar we invest in affordable housing for very low income or for homeless folks, we save the state $1.44. Thoughts on that? So I'll just keep talking.
She's a really good speaker, so.
No, but Deb's got the stories and are far more interesting. So I'll just tell you a little bit more about what we mean by homeless services, I think, and some of the public policies that we try to help folks with. So we try on the, we call it a housing continuum. So the very best and cheapest, smartest thing we can do is prevent homelessness for someone before it occurs. And so at the state level, we have this family homeless prevention program that's administered locally and in local communities all across the state. And so the idea with that, if we can keep someone housed before they become, you know, before they hit rock bottom, that's the best thing. Or if we can rehouse them quickly after they become homeless, before the kids have to, you know, change schools and all kinds of health crises pile up. So prevention is one end of the continuum. The next, if someone does become homeless, we feel like they need emergency shelter of some kind. And so in different parts of the state, it looks different. Sometimes it's a shelter. Sometimes it's a ticket to a hotel or motel if there's not a shelter in the community. But somehow we need to temporarily house people. When we started shelters in Minnesota, the idea was that it would be for 30 days. Someone would just be like, no longer than a month, they would come there and then they would find other ways of moving on. Now people end up staying a lot longer because there aren't options to move them along, even though people try real, real hard. And after shelter or, so these, you don't always go from one to the next, because obviously if you're prevented, if your homelessness is prevented, you don't come to shelter, but it's kind of a level of intensity thing. So some folks, when they become homeless, need transitional housing, which is the next stop on our continuum. And transitional housing is a state program where you can stay for up to 2 years, and you pay some portion of your income in rent. You get services, but the idea with transitional housing is just exactly like its name. It's you're transitioning from point A to point B in your life. And so sometimes these are homeless youth who are transitioning from, you know, a life of chaos to learning some basic living skills to, you know, learning how to write a resume, get job experience, and then they're going to be okay to be on their own. Or sometimes it's victims of domestic violence come in with their credit all wrecked as part of the abuse they experience. Sometimes all kinds of physical trauma and mental, emotional trauma. And so they set goals. Each person sets goals differently, and over time they get to where they need to be. Or sometimes combat veterans come back and need a period of transition. Some people won't get from point A to point B in 24 months or less, and so we have permanent supportive housing. And this is housing that's really designed, you can stay as long as you want. You still have to be working on some issues to try to stabilize. Like, we're always trying to move people towards greater stability. And then after that, there's those rental assistance vouchers I talked about, and just trying to build more housing. So we advocate for that entire continuum, and we think that every community in the state should have that entire continuum to be able to meet people wherever they're at, and we think that's most cost-effective and the best use of public policy. Questions about that? Yeah.
Well, 60% of renters in Duluth are cost-burdened. Is that 30% of low income for those either who don't know? According to the government, that makes other things like fresh food and medical supplies unaffordable. So we have a service sector in the country that accounts for 80% of American jobs. And when these houses that you see around us were built, they were purchased by those who were in the industrial sector, who were part of unions and had higher wages. Mm-hmm. So a majority of America is in the sector that doesn't produce enough buying power to pay for the homes of our parents and grandparents.
Mm-hmm.
So when you say that we want more transitional housing, and I would agree, because we need a different type of housing that people can afford. And the new stat is what? You need for a minimum wage, you need to work 78 hours a week to afford a market rate to a bedroom in Duluth.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a problem that's persisting.
Yep. Yeah, so you're exactly right. The challenge we have is partly wages just haven't kept up with the cost of housing. So we try to tackle it from two ends at my shop and other advocates. So one is, we call this the Homes for All campaign, where we ask for increases for this continuum and target it especially where we need them the most. And so we'll talk later about specific actions you can do, but one is just to remember those words, Homes for All. It's a campaign. It's into its fourth year now. Over the past 3 years, we've increased state funding for this continuum by $170 million. Last year was a $100 million investment, and that's some of what you're getting at. Not nearly enough of that money came to Duluth, but the idea is that it really is geared towards people, low-income and extremely low-income folks. And so we're trying to get more state investment. We've really seen bipartisan support for housing at the legislature. This year we're asking for $39 million in appropriations for this continuum. The other thing we work on is to try to increase wages. And there's many, many different ways of doing that. But the one niche we focus on at my shop, and then we support others who are working on other things, is for the welfare to work population. And so you might know that, let's do a quiz on welfare to work. Nines and tens, if you're super expert at it, or you know, familiar, you have family member or friend who's been on welfare to work or the state MFIT program, one and two if you, you know some of the stereotypes or really don't know much about it at all. So how many of you closer to nines and tens, pretty familiar with the state's MFIT program? How many of you kind of in the middle, five, six, seven? How many of you one, two, three? Okay, so let me just tell you that back in the day, people could be on public assistance for years and years and years. Bill Clinton and that Congress changed that, put a 60-month limit on it. And so if your Facebook feed is anything like mine, half of your Facebook friends don't know this fact, that there is a lifetime limit for how long families can be on welfare or on public assistance. And so the lifetime limit is 60 months. The fact is most people come on for 18 months and then leave when they come on, so they're not like just sitting on the couch watching TV and using up the clock. They come to public assistance from a series of low-wage jobs, and when they lose those jobs, when middle-income people lose their jobs through no fault of your own, we often qualify for unemployment insurance, and so that tides us over a little bit as we look for new work or gain new skills and try to get back in the job market. When low-wage workers lose their jobs, they often do not qualify for unemployment insurance, and so they come to the state's welfare to work program. When a middle-income worker loses their job, I won't ask this, so you don't have to say if you've been on unemployment, but generally when you go on unemployment, you make a phone call or you can register online, you tell them your social security number, maybe your wages, you know, that, and then the money can come directly to your bank account. Pretty slick. You might have to report some things. When a low-wage worker loses their job and comes to welfare, public assistance, they have to go meet in person with a county worker. They have to list all of their, everything they own, like to figure out what the total assets are they have to make sure that their car isn't too fancy, or they have to name who the father of their children are, and if they don't know, they have to list potential people who might be the father of their children. They have to document that they're spending 25 hours a week either looking for work or working. When they go to job interviews, they have to have someone sign off that they came to the job interview. If they come to class, they have to have the professor or someone sign off that they came to class. So we mandate the dickens out of how they live their lives. But the fact is the cash grant for folks hasn't increased since 1986 in Minnesota. So wages obviously have gone up. A couple years ago, we did a guidebook for legislators comparing what things look like in 1986, what a cell phone looked like in 1986 to what it looks like now. What legislators, two of our legislators that year were born in 1986. So we showed their baby pictures and what it looked like now, and you know, what a gallon of gas cost in 1986 and what it costs now. And then the cash grant has stayed the same, but obviously housing costs have gone through the roof. And so we're trying to work with that program to just give people a little more opportunity so that when they come on from these low-wage jobs, they're on public assistance for a while, and they leave and they go to the very same low-wage jobs. And so we haven't, as a public policy issue, we have done almost nothing to improve their lives or to improve our investment as taxpayers, because they came to the same low-wage job. They're going to do that until their hours get cut again, and they're going to come back on public assistance. And so each year we try to peel back some of the bad stuff that are just extra hoops they have to jump through, and we try to add a couple of good things. So in 2014, we eliminated the requirement that there used to be a restriction on how long you could study to get your GED or high school diploma as allowable activities if you were on public assistance. So these are very, very poor families. Only 40% of them have a high school diploma or GED. And we said, we do not want you doing that. We'd rather have you filling out job applications for McDonald's and Target over and over and over again, even if you're in Eveleth, where there is like only two employers. We'd rather you were doing that than working on your high school diploma or GED. And then similarly with college, we said, we don't want you going to college. Go fill out rewrite your resume, do whatever you need, you know, but do not go to college. when all the other data says, and the reason so many of us are here at UMD is we know that we can get better earnings if we go to college. And so in 2014, we repealed those things. So if someone wants to get their high school diploma or GED, they can. It's an allowable use of the time where, when we check off, like, are you behaving yourself, to say you did those things is an allowable activity that you won't get penalized for, or going to school is an allowable activity. So those things by themselves aren't going to fix the wage gap and get people's incomes, but we think for that population, and especially when we know so many of the homeless are families, we feel like we have a responsibility to invest what we can in our advocacy efforts to that. So that campaign's called Prosperity for All, and this year we're going to be asking, so again, the cash grant has not increased since 1986. We've been looking at what it costs for transportation for families in different communities. You know, to bring your kids to childcare and then get yourself to work or to school and get back to pick them up and, you know, like that whole thing. Indeed, other lots of folks have done studies on this and found, you know, anywhere from a few hundred bucks a month in some areas to $1,200 a month in other areas. And so we're going to try to add a transportation allowance to the cash grant as just a small way of trying to give people just a little bit more help as they struggle through trying to improve their lives. So I'm kind of dominating here.
Oh, that's good. Okay.
So I want to say just a couple things you can do about legislative action, I guess. Then we've got a short little video to watch, and then we'll open it up for discussion. But from the super easy to the little more complicated, first of all, we already did this, show of hands. So look up who represents you. You might remember this from ninth grade, so forgive me if you know this, but each one of us has one state senator and one state representative representing us in St. Paul, if you're on the Minnesota side, or the same deal if you're in Wisconsin, one state senator, one state representative. We also send people to Washington, D.C. So for that, you have two U.S. senators and one U.S. congressperson representing you. But really get to know who your state representative, state senator are. Google it. There's all kinds of district finders. You can put in your address. It'll tell you who they are. And then see if they're on Facebook or on Twitter. Follow them, start to get to know them a little bit if you can, and then talk to them about whatever issue you're worried about. If you're sick of the potholes, talk about that. If you want your tuition to be changed, talk about that. If you want, like, whatever, like, let them know what's on your mind, because it's the only way they're gonna know what you care about. And if they're not hearing from you, they're not going to be able to represent your interests. Make sense? On our Facebook feeds, we also sometimes, at least on my Facebook feed, some of my friends talk a lot of smack about elected officials. How many of you are familiar with people talking bad about Congress or elected officials? Yeah, so I'm not alone. So I want you to know that for you, try to establish a positive relationship. So don't tag your state senator and call him an asshole. You know, don't, like, try to establish a positive relationship. And I can tell you, I used to be on the city council, as you heard, and I'm lesbian, and it was Eveleth, where that was kind of a hard thing for a lot of people. And so some people would come to me and say, I hate you, and I hate everything you stand for, and this is, you know, you're the problem, you're the reason our local government aid is being cut, and you're the reason the jobs aren't, you know, it's all because you're gay, and this is terrible, and you need to get out of town. And then if they treated me like that, and then said, like, and I've got a pothole, you know, on my street, will you get right over here and fix it? I felt in my own heart that I maybe didn't have as much urgency for them as the people who told me respectfully, even if they had a hard time accepting me for who I am, but were respectful about it and said, you know, I'm really struggling with this. It's very much against, you know, my religious traditions or whatever, but, you know, I respect you and the work you're trying to do, and I've got this pothole. I found myself to, you know, work on that a little bit faster. And so So, and then of course there were the ones who were just like, you go girl, like you, my daughter's so, you know, happy to be out and inspired by your story. And I found even more passion and energy and time for those folks, I think. But you have enormous power as a constituent to get your legislator to do things for you or to weigh in on issues you care about. But you'll be more effective in doing that if you can talk to them respectfully, and if they know your name as someone who's, you know, kind of watching what they're doing, liking their stuff on Facebook when they post things they're working on that you like. Then when you ask them to invest in Homes for All campaign or the Prosperity for All campaign, they're probably a little bit more likely to do that. I'd also encourage you to like us, the Minnesota Coalition for the Homeless, on Facebook. So we post actions you can take, but we also post job opportunities when they open up in our sector, as we know about them. So students sometimes are interested in that, or internships. But it's a way of just kind of keeping track of what's going on. And we always give you opportunities to get involved. And so you can find us, Minnesota Coalition for the Homeless, on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram. And yeah, I'm wondering if we should switch to the video. Should we? We got to.
Oh, okay. Yeah, if you want. I forgot how we said that. Oh, let's see. We got to be here.
Oh, whoops. You did the wrong.
End of show.
Do you want to, tell us what
this
is?
Yeah, so one of the reasons, like, I just heard Liz was going to be here, and then she's like, do you want to join me? So she's really the expert around the state. You know, I've done outreach and worked with homeless folks for about 16 years, mostly on the street. I've worked with singles, and I take a lot of pictures. We have a Facebook page, too. It's called Homeless Taking It to the Streets, Duluth, Minnesota. So, I mean, lots of times... and Loaves and Fishes, too, on their Facebook page. Lots of times you can find some needs or just some things that are going on that we might need help with. So I think that pictures, anybody know Danny Bodwa? Am I saying his last name right? He did a, wasn't Danny from UMD? Did Susan leave? Danny, I thought Danny that did the portraits. Yeah, he did the portraits at the Capitol.
Yeah.
So he, you know, I just think with, I think if you can really see it, it makes it, you know, it brings it home more. So this is just a little, I like to play around with my pictures. So I just made a little PowerPoint or a Vimeo video. And this is all of folks experiencing homelessness in Duluth. So it's about 5 minutes, and I guess, here we go.
I live. inside my head. It's all that's left. This is my house. This is my bed.
So some of these pictures were from Graffiti Graveyard.
Tell us what Graffiti Graveyard is.
It's a Graffiti Graveyard is kind of like, it's underneath the freeway down by Red Lobster, where last summer it became like an encampment for a bunch of people experiencing homelessness. Lots of times when people are experiencing homelessness and they live in a place like that together, they become real, you know, tight, like family. They take care of each other, watch out for each other. Through the whole summer, the police were working with outreach workers and visiting people in the camp. There was concerns, you know, there were some things going on, you know, relating to drinking, you know, things that sometimes happen when people are drinking, fights, concern about, like, if there was a medical issue, how are we going to get people out of here? Because how many of you have been down to Graffiti Graveyard? So it's kind of hard to get in. So if you had a medical emergency, you'd have a hard time getting someone out. So I think, you know, over the summer and into the early fall last year, the police, everybody was, you know, we were all working together really great, and then all of a sudden there was an assault down there, which kind of escalated the need to get them moved out of there. So it started a lot of, you know, action in Duluth, so in the end it was a good thing, but at the time, all those folks, there was 14 to 16 people down there that were displaced. So a year later, two of those people are still experiencing homelessness. So it took a whole year to get like 12 people housed, you know. So maybe some were housed sooner, but so I don't know. I think it prompted a lot of good things in the city of Duluth, though. We now have like a homeless bill of rights, which it doesn't have a lot of teeth right now. So I don't really even know how to talk about it. Barb, maybe you can talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, I'm on the city council in Duluth, and we approved having a homeless bill of rights. It's now in the hands of the Human Rights Commission to kind of figure out exactly what the content will be. But one other thing that we are bringing forward is to add the status of being homeless as a protected class. That it is not a protected class in state law or any other law that I'm aware of, but so often people who are homeless certainly believe that they are not treated fairly by others, whether it's storekeepers or property owners or police or whatever, but we want to make sure that people are not treated differently just because someone happens to believe they're homeless or knows that they are homeless. So that's that hasn't passed yet. It's something that I'm going to bring back to the council, and hopefully we can get that into our ordinance. It won't be in state law.
So, I mean, in the end, like, some good things came out of that. We do have the commission now, so that, but every year it's re-educating the police. We get new officers. I'm a person that personally feels like I work a lot with I tend to talk about what I do more than anything. I mean, of course, I work with the singles. I have a close relationship with working with the community police officers who actually refer people to me. So I'm working with the ones that, you know, are in and out of detox, in and out of jail, in and out of the hospital, using the emergency rooms. And I think it's a lot of, you know, my relationship, I feel, with the downtown police, I think they're great dealing with these situations. But it's always like re-educated and re-educating the police and the community. So I feel like when we walked in here tonight, a lot of you guys really knew nothing about homelessness. I mean, there was a lot of people that raised their hands, and that surprised me. I hope that when you leave here today, you know something about homelessness in your community. There's a lot of opportunities to help. You know, you can find it from, you know, from the CHUM website. There's the Human Development Center. They have a homeless project. The Salvation Army, Loaves and Fishes. The Damiano Center. There's just a lot of good agencies, and there's a lot of different ways people can help or just learn about what's going on. Hopefully, who feels like they learned something about Duluth and the state tonight? Great.
So I want to just summarize a couple of things that I'm hoping you got from this, and then we have a little bit of time for discussion. And since a lot of what we do is advocacy, and since you've got a city councilor here, maybe we could just practice lobbying right now, especially about, you know, what should we, for ethics, you know, what should we, you know, what protection should we offer people who are homeless? But I want you to know that homelessness exists. You know, if you know that, if you remember that it's more than 10,000 lakes, so it's more than 10,000 homeless people every single night in Minnesota. I want you to know that there are solutions, and there are solutions here in Duluth. There are solutions across the state. We are making progress every day. We are housing some people. It's just that others are becoming homeless. So we know how to end homelessness. We just got to ramp it up a little bit. There's a state plan to end homelessness. There's a county plan. The city's part of the county plan to end homelessness. So there's things we can do. And then the other thing I want you to know equally strongly is that it will take you doing something to help fix it. And that there are easy things you can do, whether it's sharing, liking things on Facebook to just kind of let people know there are people who care about this, and we're trying to get the word out, all the way to, we have a homeless day on the Hill, March 12th, where we all go down to St. Paul and we talk about our specific legislative agenda. You'll find that on our Facebook page as well, and opportunities to get involved. I want you all to think about running for office yourself sometime. I just think that we need all of us doing a little bit, and if you haven't been to a city council meeting or a county board meeting or to the state legislature, if you just it's you can see yourself there, I think, after you attend one or watch it on TV or something. So think about that and the policies you would shape if you were sitting there, and then try to help your current electeds understand what those policies are. So homelessness exists. There are solutions. There's money available to do something about it, and it'll take all of us just doing a little bit of work to get it done. Questions on this before we talk about specifically ideas for the this thing we're putting together about protecting homeless people in the city of Duluth. Questions or comments, discussions, disagreements? Yeah. Yeah.
Do you guys do like any sort of work with banks to like, take those homes and like, make them transition to housing or anything?
Yeah, so I don't know if folks could hear in the back, but just all these foreclosed homes that aren't on the market. My shop doesn't do that, but we work with partners who do. And so the big hassle, and this could be another discussion all by itself or something, write papers on for extra credit, but just the mess our banks have with... if they write that off, like if they give their house away, it looks like they're losing money on the stock market, and so it costs them more money. And so so it's just a rigged system, rigged against the people who really need to live in those empty houses. And so one of the best solutions is to buy them in bulk from the banks with public dollars at a reduced rate, and then open them up. And so there are efforts to do that. Around, but definitely need to be ramped up. And we need to fix this issue of banks owning homes anyway. I think that's a big, much bigger reform some other day. Other thoughts? Yeah.
I just want to encourage people to be passionate about homelessness, but as a landlord, sometimes people want to attack landlords, sometimes people want to attack, you know, people in office,
passionate, but be really mindful of who you decide to attack. It's nice to be able to say, that's the problem, and if we just fix those people, it would be a problem, but it's not ever that simple. And
yeah.
We need to be respectful, as you said, of people in office. We need to be respectful of all people that are out there trying to do something, developers, all those folks, you know, they're trying to do good. Yeah, there's bad apples, but, you know, we can work with that. It's not ever helpful to attack one particular entity and
yeah.
That's going to solve it.
And I just like to say one thing about that, because it's really from my job, what I do, like meeting somebody on the street, this to the landlord, to the city councilor, to the legislator, to the Congress, it's all about relationship building. It's like, you know, and that's how I meet with folks. I can tell you countless stories of people that have been on the streets for years that you meet with them, you give them something to meet their needs, keep them safe. They don't really want your help, they'll take your stuff. 4 years later, you've been doing this for 4 years, and then all of a sudden they'll say, we want housing. So it's about relationship building with all of these entities. And, you know, I didn't know much about politics either, you know, when I started doing this, and I don't necessarily care for them, but I realized the importance of, you know, needing to be involved in them, so.
I was just going to add to that vote.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Over 40% of the houses in Duluth, I understand from someone else's quote, are rental. That's a huge number of votes out there. Vote in the city elections, you know, find out who the candidates are. Out there and vote. You're important.
And when you can be in a place to buy properties, rent them out, and be a landlord yourself, it's a huge part of probably everyone. We move out of homelessness ends up in rental housing for a while until they can get into a Habitat home or something else, but landlords are a huge part of the solution. So I know it's late and folks want it, but I'm wondering if we could spend just at least 5 minutes brainstorming together what we might want to put in the city books around protecting homeless people who are finding themselves to be treated differently because they're homeless. Just thoughts on that, or do you have questions about what that looks like? Why people, some people feel like homeless people are treated different because they're homeless, or just or do you think they should be treated differently? Or just let's discuss. Yeah.
That's an interesting thought. There's a class-based society, and a lot of lower-income people don't have access to a lot of the good things in life that rich people do. So drawing a line and saying, you know, these are people that need to be protected because they don't have as much money, but once you're not homeless, or if you are homeless, then, you know, so it's a fickle line to draw in the sand, or is it the fact that we've been advocating politics for 30, 40 years, environmentalists, philanthropists, civil rights activists, you name it, and we have continued to have perpetual and cyclical problems throughout the system, and maybe it's not reform within the system that we need, but maybe we need to take a step back and look at, I don't know how to sum up, but maybe everybody can look up into the global justice movement or the zeitgeist movement, and you can kind of see what it, you know, perpetuates this disparity.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And I just personally feel like we need to do both and continue to work for a world that everyone's treated much better in, but at the same time, not make the folks who are really treated really, really poorly wait for the, you know, global revolution to wrap up. Do you have Barbara, are you going to say something? Or?
Well, here's an example of some complaints that I've heard from folks who are chronically homeless is, why is it illegal to sleep outside? And in Duluth, we have a lot of land that's parkland, a lot of things that you wouldn't realize is actually considered a city park. And our city parks close at 10 o'clock at night. Everybody has to be out of our parks at 10 o'clock at night. And so someone can't even, like, down on a park point, not bothering anybody, and just, I know this one fellow, he had a dog, so he couldn't be at Chump, for example. Summertime, sleeping out on the beach. Someone complained and said, there's somebody sleeping on the beach. Law enforcement goes, well, you gotta leave, it's after 10 o'clock. Those kinds of things are what people, it's an annoyance thing, but it's, you know, so where is this person supposed to sleep? Where would it be legal to sleep, you know? And so those are the kinds of things that you don't realize are a huge thing for somebody who doesn't have anywhere else to go and sleep.
Yeah. For me, and not to slam business owners, because I totally understand why they do this, but the sign on the door or the window that so often says restrooms for customers only, like I find that I can sometimes, you know, if I really need to use the restroom, I can go into there anyway and just say, you know, I'm sorry, it's really important, it's really urgent, and it's fine. You know, but if I looked homeless, they wouldn't, you know, I wouldn't have the same access. And so I think... you know, but I understand that these are private business owners who don't want to have a public restroom, you know, so there's a little bit of thoughts on that. How about just if we talk about just the sleeping in public places, sleeping in city parks, should that be illegal or unethical or okay, or do you have something on that or something else?
Well, I know, like, for in Duluth, or just, like, so some people don't come to shelter because they have a, you know, they have some kind of a mental illness that they cannot be around people, they can't deal with the shelter scene. Shelters can be very chaotic, you know, you've got a, you know, a variety of people living there. Some people get kicked out for that. There's two things you can get kicked out of CHUM for, violence and drinking, so... So if you're kicked out for violence, you might be kicked out forever. So then you're never going to get shelter there again unless you make a major life change. If you're drinking and you leave willingly, you know, you might, you'll be out for one night. If you need to take a breathalyzer test, you're out for 30 days. And then there's just people that just don't, they don't do shelters. They have maybe have pets, like Barb said. So they're going to, they want, that's their family. They want to sleep outside with their pets. But a lot of, I think a lot of it revolves around the addiction piece, the mental illness, having pets, and then just not liking shelters in general. So,
but and our shelters are full. We don't have enough shelter beds for everybody. And yeah.
Just a question: how come your shelters don't allow pets?
Well, I don't know. For allergies, for one thing.
And some of our shelters were about as crowded as we are here, but just like laying down. And so, you know, you'd have your and pets fighting pets and, you know, so.
Yeah, there is a recent shelter right now. I can't think of it, but they got a grant from PetSmart and they've added kennels. I don't know if anybody saw that, but I thought that was an excellent idea because I've actually become the foster home for a lot of people experiencing homelessness in Duluth. I've had a lot of pets.
What do you have right now, six?
Well, I have two fosters and four of my own, but all of them came from homeless people. So, but I mean, there is a need for fostering pets for people experiencing homelessness. There's a need for pet care, you know. So this is all, again, about relationship building. I mean, Doherty's Vet, Animal Control, like, they work really good with us, you know. There's people get their cars impounded. You know, if you don't have any money, you're sleeping in your car, now it's impounded. You know, it's $300 to get it out. Like, where do you get that? Where do you get help to get that out? So, there's not a lot of money to pay for stuff like that. So that's where a place like where the community has to step up sometime, and we all have to maybe give a little. But yeah, I use Facebook a lot when I'm looking for a foster home. So.
Well, and I think we even come into a problem with people with pets because some people have a passion for animals. Most people have pets. Feel better, you know, it's one to care for that cares for you, and so people out of shelter because they can't bring their pets there, and it can be confusing because a lot of people think maybe they can't because they have a pet. They might even, their therapist or some mental health professional might have written them a letter that allows them to have a pet with them, but that's not the same thing as a service dog, it's not the same thing as a trained dog with papers that lets them come into, you know, airports or other public places. So that whole pet thing, it can be really tricky. So when do we want to start a nonprofit like a
that's the one
I would love to. I mean, another thing why people don't come, like they do, like Liz was saying earlier, there lots. There is a 30-day limit on shelters, but I mean, we have it too at Chum, and there's an expectation that if you get money, you need to save some for housing. So, but as far as the 30-day, I mean, there's people that have been there 6 months, 9 months, because you're never ever going to find housing in 30 days. So, I mean, as long as you're working with somebody, you're not going to get kicked out. But you know, the 30-day thing is just ridiculous because you'll never get, there's no immediate housing for anyone.
I think the belongings piece is tricky too. If you become homeless and shelter becomes your only option, there is no storage at shelter. All you can bring into shelter is what you can carry yourself, and it needs to stay with you in your reach the whole time. So if you're in an apartment and you're losing everything, that's a very stark contrast. You know, what are you going to do with, you know, all of your possessions? So I think some people try and stay outside because at least they can accumulate or have a couple things with them that they wouldn't be able to have in shelter.
Are there questions? Comments?
What about the idea of designating a park for,
it's been talked about.
Is that something that the council is considering?
The council isn't considering anything. It's the Human Rights Commission. But I don't think that's a bad idea. You know, I mean, the city administration will be concerned about liability, I'm sure, because you saw the recent news about this largest homeless encampment is out in Silicon Valley right now. I mean, it's thousands and thousands of people, and many of them work for these tech companies, but their wages are not sufficient.
They can't get any big
to have housing, so it's unbelievable. And it's become absolute power unto itself. And that number of people, you're going to have problems. You know, people who aren't going to get along. You're going to have people stealing things. You're going to have, that just happens when you have a whole bunch of people saying to live together. So that would be a concern that the city would have, just all of that piece. There is an architect in town working on this idea of container being used somehow in creating housing, small housing for people. I don't know what's happening with that. I'm very making recent notes about it. But there's all sorts of ideas kind of floating around, and there again, you need to find a parcel of land where you could do that, and you know, so on and so forth, and nothing's free, of course. So there's a lot of ideas, but
yeah, I'd really encourage us all to, like, while we deal with the emergency crisis, to continue to build housing and make sure it's affordable and, you know, use every resource the city has to make that, you know, and I know Duluth's working hard on that. But I want to, just before I wrap up, I just want to acknowledge that I know there are students on campuses all across the state who are homeless, and there might very well be people here with us today who don't have places to stay. I want you to know that I know that I experience, like I often when I go talk at campuses, people come up and tell me that. We work real, real, real hard to try to address that, get student housing, get housing for everybody. And so we understand if you're in that situation or you have friends who are, just the extra huge burden you have to get through your classes when you're not sure where you're sleeping tonight or you're bouncing from place to place. So a special shout out to you. And then just thanks to you all for, I know you had probably lots of other things you could be doing today, but I think we'll wrap up unless you have final, no. All right, so thanks so much for coming and everything you're gonna do to help.
Excellent job.
Got that. Thank you.